specimen collection, transportation for testing. So why specimen collection is important in microbiology? First you should understand. So why specimen collection is important in microbiology? The specimen collection in microbiology to isolate and identify the causative agents forms backbone of the investigative procedure. So specimen collection in microbiology to isolate and identify the causative agents forms backbone of the investigative procedure. So that is why sample collection is very important. And if you see in the developing world, lack of awareness and casual attitude among junior staff hampers the definitive diagnosis. Specific procedures in collecting specimens will certainly improve the quality of services of microbiology departments. Means, see, the being a person in nursing profession, you should know this importance of specimen collection. Specimen collection, when you are doing collection for testing something, it should be done very carefully. Because any change or any contamination can give a false negative report or false positive report. So in such cases, what will happen? Unnecessarily, the patient should go treatment for their for the wrong testing. So specimen collection is very important and should be transported in a proper container and should be transported without any contamination. Then only you will be able to get the accurate results. So specimen collection is very important and it forms the backbone for the investigation procedures to identify the reason. And the junior staff or the nursing staff should be knowing about this, because when you go for hospital postings, you will be working in hospitals. So on the ward side, when you are supposed to collect the blood sample for testing of microbiology test or biochemistry test or pathology test, you should collect the sample in such a way so that there is no contamination, so that they will not give false positive or wrong reports. So specimen collection is very, very important and nursing people should know that. So what are the important questions that you should know before collecting a specimen? So are you suspecting an infection? If the doctor is suspecting an infection, then you can go for collection of sample. If so, what is the nature of infection? Example, you are suspecting bacterial infection or viral infection or mycological or parasitological infection. What type of an infection you are suspecting? That you should have a clarity in collection of sample. Then which test you are going to do for identification of infection? That you should have an idea. Then when to collect the specimen? Suppose there are some special investigations, the specimen to be collected at specific times. So when the specimen to be collected, that should also known by the nursing staff. And how to collect the specimen? Now once the test is ordered by the physician for the patient, then the patient will come to the laboratory for the specimen handling. So the specimen will be collected from the patient by the laboratory staff. Now how to collect the specimen and all, laboratory staff will take care. Or if at all, if it is, the sample has to be collected on the bedside, in the ward side, then the nursing staff may should assist in collection of sample. Then you should also know whether you are selecting the correct container for the collection of specimen. There are different containers are there for specimen collection. For urine, there is a different container. For urine routine, different container. For urine culture, different container will be there. For blood samples, different containers will be there. For blood cultures, different containers will be there. So being a nursing staff, you must know what type of containers you have to we are using in the lab, and what type of container you have to select for the collection of sample, you should also know. Then why to send the specimens promptly? If not, what should I do? So you have to collect the specimen in the given guidelines. As per the given guidelines, you have to collect the specimen and you should send it to the laboratory for testing. If it is not done, so what you have to do, that also you should know. So phishing for diagnosis in laboratories means the physicians and microbiologists should be aware of the clinical manifestations before undertaking the test. So microbiological tests are expensive and technically demanding. So unnecessarily you should not ask the patient to undergo these tests unnecessarily, because these tests are expensive and technically they are very costly. So the casual testing of microbiology tests is not recommended. It is not useful. Okay, so exactly you should do the testing. You should do the testing exactly. So policies on specimen collection have been laid down by many regulatory authorities, like we have NABL, means National Accreditation Board for Laboratories, and NABH, National Accreditation Board for Hospital. They have given some guidelines for the laboratories to collect the specimens. Okay, so they have maintained the standard guidelines. By obeying the standard guidelines, we can change guidelines as per the requirement also. So every laboratory should formulate the guidelines on procedures for each major category of specimen and request. So every laboratory should assist extra examinations, and out with the standard procedures may be required if specifically requested by the physician, or if the clinical information provided on the request form suggests that an unusual infection may be present. So a written request, a doctor should send a written request, that is a legal document. So it identifies all the outcomes of the tests also. There is no interchange of results, and short forms are dangerous when you are reporting. Then signature of the doctor or the nurse is essential in sending the request to the lab. Can help to contact in case of results which can save a patient. So if any critical results are there, in such case if the critical results has to be reported, so concerned doctor signature or the ward in charge, ward nurse or ward nurse in charge signature should be there, so that any critical reports or any abnormal reports will be immediately reported. So on the request, test request, all these details should be present along with the patient details, age, sex, then the diagnosis, the nature of the test to be marked on the sample request which they are sending to the lab. So when the patient is serious, write a telecontact number also, which can help in prompt delivery of results. So an ideal report request form should be containing these information. So the request form, let's say you wanted to test so and so glucose test, or so and so serology test, or so and so bacterial culture test, then the request form should be containing the name of the patient, age of the patient, sex of the patient, with proper number, IP number, means if he is an inpatient, IP number, if he is an outpatient, OP number must be there. Then what time the request is ordered, what is the date of the request sending to the lab, from which ward they are sending the sample, whether it is urgent test or the routine test they have to mark, then nature of the specimen they are sending, urine sample or blood sample or some other fluid they are sending for the testing, that should be mentioned. Investigation needed should be written clearly, and the doctor or the nursing staff signature along with the contact number should be mentioned in the request form. So this is the ideal request form presenting all the patient information and the test to be done. So once this is ready, you can send the patient along with the request to the lab, and in the lab the patient will be present for the collection of sample. So when to collect the sample is also should be known by the staff, paramedical staff or the lab staff. So there are some certain timing is there for the collection of samples. So sample collection should be done. Then what containers to be used for sample collection, that also they should know. So nursing staff or the staff who is doing the sample collection, they should know what type of container they have to use. So containers must be leak proof. When you collect the blood sample or urine sample and you have to close the cap, properly, and you should see to that there should not be any leakage. So container should be leakage proof, because if it is an infectious sample and if it gets leaked, the area where you are keeping the sample will also get infected and it may spread to many people. And containers should be unbreakable. Containers should be unbreakable. And for cultures, sterile containers should be used. Sterile containers should be used. Then after collection of the sample, you have to label the sample as high-risk specimen. Has high-risk specimen. So you, when you are transporting from the ward side to the lab, then you should label if the sample is high-risk sample. Suppose blood samples, sputum samples, fecal matter samples, the urine samples. These are all highly contaminated, highly risk samples. So they should be closed in a leak-proof container. And a suitable container you have to use for collection, and then it should be labeled, kept in a closed container, and should be labeled as high risk specimen when transporting. Okay. Then blood samples we collect for the culture. So blood samples we use this sterile culture bottles. So blood collection of for the cultures is the most important investigation. Appropriate procedures in collection should be followed. And processing, identifying and timely reporting can be life-saving. Immediately after the sample collection, the sample should be dropped from the syringe into this culture bottles for blood collection. So these culture bottles are all our sterile bottles. Now collection of blood sample is also to be done properly. So a scientific approach and dedicated staff participating in blood collection will eliminate the basic failure as contamination. So when you are collecting the blood samples, you should not make it, see to that there is no contamination before collection of sample. That is why yesterday I told you, before collection or before doing any injection or syringe inserting into the body, we will clean that particular area with the spirit. Once the spirit gets dry in that particular area, we have to insert the needle and we have to collect the sample. So while collecting the sample, the care should be taken that contamination should not take place. See here, they are using the vacutainer for the collection of blood sample. So the staff who is going to collect the blood sample must be trained in this, must be trained in collection of sample. So collection should be done under aseptic condition to avoid contamination of the samples. So hygienic precautions. And then once you, before collection, you can wash your hands cleanly. You can use the PPE, like usage of gloves and usage of mask. All these things care should be taken before collection so that contamination can be avoided. So proper handling of syringe is essential to obtain a blood specimen. So before collection, you should handle the needle carefully so that it will not cause any damage to the collecting sample or other persons also. So do not collect from the existing or indwelling catheters. When you are collecting the blood sample, you should not collect the blood from the already inserted blood catheters or existing IV cans. So always collect the blood specimens in hygienic area. Where the sample you are collecting, that area should be clean and hygienic. So samples like cerebrospinal fluid, the CSF or cerebrospinal fluid is flowing in the ventricles of the brain. So this CSF collection is a special procedure done under aseptic condition. So this CSF, for collection of CSF sample, the sample who are collecting must be wearing this PPE kit. They should wear the gloves, see the mask also they are wearing, the head cap also they are wearing, they covered themselves with the sterile dressing. That is called PPE kit, personal protective equipment. They should wear this personal protective equipment and reach the patient. Now this is the procedure for collection of CSF sample. CSF sample is collected by doing lumbar puncture procedure. Lumbar puncture procedure is done at L3 to L4. L3 means lumbar spine, L3, L4. So when you keep the patient in this position, in this lateral position, the lateral position, they should compress themselves in a stretched manner, so that L3, L4, there will be a gap. Between the L3, L4, there will be a gap. Then we have to insert the lumbar needle for collection of the CSF. And this CSF will be sent for testing. Now here you can see the patient should adjust himself in this position. The back will be stretched so that L3, L4 will be in relaxed position. So there is, in this gap, the needle will be inserted and we can collect the CSF. Collected CSF should be kept in a, should be transferred to a closed sterile containers and then should be sent for testing. So transportation of this sample to the, this is a sterile container where the CSF fluid is collected and this is closed, labeled properly and will be sent for the laboratory for testing. What testing they wanted to test also, they should write it in a sample request. Now preservation of sample you should know. So CSF should not be, sample should not be kept in the refrigerator. So it is important when there is a delay in transportation of specimen of laboratory, do not keep it in refrigerator, which will tends to kill the bacteria called influenza bacteria. If there is delay in anticipated, leave the room at room temperature. Okay, leave room temperature. And collection of samples for upper respiratory infections, we use the swabs. Swabs will be used to collect the samples from oropharynx, nasopharynx and nasal cavity. So this is how the throat swabs are collected. So a plain cotton wool swab should be used to collect as much as exudates as possible from tonsils, posterior pharyngeal wall and other area that is inflamed or bears exudates. So the tongue will be pressed like this. The patient will be asked open mouth. Tongue will be pressed with the tongue pressure. Then the clean cotton swab is allowed to touch the posterior pharyngeal wall for collection of swab. Then cooperation of the patient and ideal techniques contributes to the better results in sample collection. So once the adequate view of the throat is there, should be ensured by good lightening conditions and the use of disposable wooden spatula or a tongue depressor to pull outwards so you can depress the tongue so that you will have maximum area for collection. So for tonsils, if you can use this swab, cotton swab, to touch this posterior pharyngeal wall and tonsils to collect this swab. So that will be kept it in a closed sterile container and it will be sent to the lab for testing. Then nasal specimens. In case of nasal specimens, a deep nasal swab generally yields the same information as throat swab. Nasal swabs are taken to detect healthy carriers than diagnose deep infection. So deep infections cannot be diagnosed. Even the carriers who are having the infection in the nasal regions, so nasal swabs are used. So deep nasal are taken to diagnose some type of bacteria like diphtheria bacteria. Streptococcus pyogenes also can be detected by deep nasal swabs. So nasal swabs are also used for identifying some bacterial infections. Specimens in sinusitis. So in case of sinusitis, pus is collected or aspirated from sinus, or a saline washout should be examined in a gram film by culture on aerobic and anaerobic blood agar plates. Specimens from sinusitis are used. Collection of ear swabs in case of acute otitis media. So ear swabs are collected. So ear swabs are collected in otitis. Eye swabs also we can collect. Obtaining an adequate specimen is difficult in case of eye swabs. So it is best to make smear and see culture plates beside the patient immediately after collecting the material from the eye. So eye culture swabs and all should be inoculated immediately. So here the collection of eye swabs, how to do, is shown in this diagram. So you have to fold this eyelid and the swab should be inserted on the inner side of the conjunctiva. In case of conjunctivitis, this can be collected, ISR can be collected. So for respiratory, lower respiratory infections also, there are different techniques for collection, that is sputum. Sputum collection is used for testing the lower respiratory tract infections. So sputum always should be contained in a sterile container. It should be closed immediately after collection and closed tightly, and should be sent to the lab with proper labeling and all the details along with the test request. This sputum testing is mainly done in the identification of TB bacteria, tuberculosis bacteria. So AFB is the test we are using for confirmation in TB test, and specimens for urinary tract infections. So urine is mainly collected to assess the urinary infections or kidney infections. So a sterile container or a normal container with leak proof container should be provided to these patients for collection of urine sample. So urine collected in a wide mouth container from the patients. A midstream specimen is the most ideal for processing. So when you are collecting the urine sample, first some of the urine you should not collect. In the beginning of the urine you should void, and then you have to collect the urine in the container. And again, once the container reaches the adequate quantity, then you can close the container and rest of the urine can be voided. So a midstream specimen is ideal for the processing of urine sample. So female patients process urine with a labia separated and midstream sample is collected. So there are different methods are there for genital infections in case of woman. So genital infections, if they are present, like arthritis, vaginosis, genital ulceration, cervicitis, uterine sepsis, all these things also we have to collect this sample. So there also vaginal swab is used to understand the genital infection. And in case of gonorrhea, the endocervical swab must be collected for the examination of gonococci. A vaginal speculum must be used to provide a clear sight of the cervix, and swab is rubbed in and around the intra-aortus of the cervix and withdrawn without contamination from the vaginal wall. So speculum should be used for collection of vaginal swabs. Then once the swab is collected, all the swabs to be promptly transported to the laboratory. In case of delay or in case of decline, delicate microbes to be transported in MEs transport medium. So if possible, two swabs to be collected and submitted for each site. So each site two swabs will be collected. Suppose in case of specimen collection, in case of gonorrhea in men, the infected men are mostly caused by the same organism that is seen in the woman. So urethritis is the common presentation, may be caused by gonococci. So this, from this area we have to collect the swab and should be kept inside. So in case of gonococcal infection, there will be leakage from the urethra. The urethral discharge can be collected on the slides and inoculated on warmed plates of heated blood agar or selective medium for isolation of gonococci is used. Other genital infections, when prostatitis is suspected, there is no spontaneous discharge from urethra, and massage of the prostate per rectum may express some exudate for examination and culture. So in such cases, the examination of chancres is required for careful collection of exudates, and its preparation of dark ground microscopy is also used. Many patients need clotted blood for specific serological investigation. So specimen collection from wound, skin and deep sepsis. Let's say this is a wound from where the pus or exudates is often submitted on a swab for laboratory investigation. So the swabs are inefficient sampling device in such cases, tends to desiccate the specimen and trap the bacteria, which are then not released onto the culture plate. From these areas, any exudate is there, that exudate will be collected with the help of swab and will be sent. Okay. So like this, for gastrointestinal infections also, we have many sample collection procedures.